It's time for Mac Break Weekly. Andy's here, Renee's here, Lori's here, and we all got invitations. You probably did too, to the Apple event next week. We get Renee Ritchie's fever dream predictions about what he wants Apple to announce next week. We'll talk about what Apple more likely will announce next week. Also, some changes in the Apple Store that may be an indicator that something else is going on soon. The T2 chip, why you shouldn't be too worried about security issues with that. Apple Watch getting in gear, and some new shows for Apple TV. Plus, there's lots to talk about. It's all next on Mac Break Weekly. Mac Break Weekly is brought to you from LastPass Studios. Securing every access point in your company doesn't have to be a challenge. LastPass unifies access and authentication to make securing your employees simple and secure, even when they're working remotely. Check out lastpass.com/twit to learn more.
Podcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
This is Mac Break Weekly, episode 734, recorded Tuesday, October 6th, 2020. Schmigadoon. This episode of Mac Break Weekly is brought to you by ExtraHop. ExtraHop helps you keep your business secure and available with SaaS-based cloud-native network detection and response. Learn more about how ExtraHop stops breaches 70% faster and experience the free trial for yourself at extrahop.com/twit. And by Worldwide Technology. Worldwide Technology's advanced technology center is like no other testing and research lab, with more than $500 million of equipment, including solutions from key partners like Intel Corporation. And it's virtual, so you can access it 24/7. To learn more and to get insights into all that the ATC offers, go to wwt.com/twit. It's time for Mac Break Weekly, the show where we cover the latest news from Apple. And there is news from Apple, so it's good. Lori Gill is here. She is the managing editor at imore.com. Hello, Ms. Gill.
Hiya. Big news.
Hiya. Thank you also to Andy Anatko from WGBH in Boston, our East Coast reporter. Welcome back. He has more stripes.
Always nice to be here.
But you can't see them all.
I promise you, I bought more than one stripe. I can afford a polo shirt with multiple stripes, everybody. So people saying that, hey, he can only afford the one stripe, that's just a lie.
They're so broad. And from Montreal, new COVID hotspot, we welcome Renee Ritchie of YouTube fame, youtube.com/Renee Ritchie. Okay, show of hands.
Sir, I know Andy Anatko. I've seen Andy Anatko. I've met Andy Anatko, and it stripes all the way down.
All the way down. Show of hands, did anyone get an invitation this morning?
Virtual, but yes.
Hey, guess who has two thumbs and got an invitation?
Ooh.
This guy. Yeah. So the last time I thought, oh, it was a bug. They sent out that weird invitation saying, you want your briefing? Here's your briefing. And then they retracted it. But yes, I got another invitation. Here it is. We kind of thought this would happen. If Apple was going to have an event on October 13th, they would announce it today, October 6th, a week early. This is the invite. It says high speed, and it's not H-I-G-H, it's H-I comma speed. Hello. It's like saying, hello, speed. Please join us for a special Apple event in Apple Park. The Apple logo is surrounded by concentric rings. Some have interpreted that as the 5G radios. But I love in our chat room said, you know, maybe that's Apple tags.
If your name is Speed, were you very confused about the personalization of this invitation?
Wow, they sent me a personal invite. Yeah, that would be.
I wonder
be
what
fun.
Yours said, Leo.
Hi, Leo. No, mine just said high speed as well. So, yeah, I mean, it's not like inviting you to Apple campus to go, but I'm hoping that they get in the habit of this. And then
yeah. Seating is unlimited for this one.
Yeah, that's right. I might be the 18,000th person on the list, but I am.
But you're on the list, and that's the important part.
So what we're going to do next week, just a programming note, is we'll, as we did last time, with the iPad announcement and the Apple Watch announcement, we'll start iOS today an hour or two early, probably around 8 o'clock. Pacific time, 11 Eastern. And then that way Micah and I can do the announcement, which is at 10 o'clock Pacific time, 1 p.m. Eastern, 1700 UTC. And then we'll start MacBreak Weekly immediately after the Apple announcement. They're pretty disciplined at this point. I imagine they'll do. You know, it's funny. Google did its thing last week, and it was like 29 minutes and 59 seconds. It was like half hour, boom, it's over. They edited it to time.
Yeah.
Apple didn't do that, did they? It was a little longer than an hour, I think.
Yeah, and, and you're forgetting that included a blooper reel, like just like, you know, Cannonball Run, where they had like, you know, Burt Reynolds breaking up and playing jokes on yeah. So, yeah.
So
it's a new era.
I also think Google was just anxious to get it over with. Let's go back to bed. It was their night in announcement. There are not.
Let's put this way. Switch.
Like we have any chance of getting any attention during a news cycle during this month of this year in this world.
So why bother? They couldn't be bothered to have Google I/O. They barely could be bothered to do a Pixel event, which means they're clearing the way for Samsung and Apple to dominate, which they would do anyway. So this is an iPhone 12 announcement, right?
Probably.
Yeah. Did anyone check Mark Gurman's Twitter? Come on, did anyone check Mark Gurman's Twitter?
Prosser said last night this would be, we'd all be getting this, but I could have tweeted that. Actually did, Renee, a really good piece on, why are we listening to these people with zero track record in their iPhone rumors?
Yeah. They're being blogged over and over again, and it's out. I get it. I get like the thirst for page views during the time of COVID. I'm not going to look at Lori. I can't even imagine the pressure being put on, you know, professional bloggers these days. But I think not on iMore. iMore is rigorous about this stuff, but on some other sites, I think anytime they see a tweet, it just gets a blog post.
For a long time, I actually resisted doing rumors of any kind. But I realized that was the road to hell paved with good intents. So we started doing rumors judiciously.
What I like about the rumor stuff, though, is that it makes it fun to talk about what you're excited for. You know, so there's somebody might have a rumor of like the new iPhone color, and then you get to say like, ooh, wouldn't that be so great if that's real? I would love that new color. And then it gets you all excited about it. So it's not about like, for me, when I talk about rumors, it's not about believing what people say as much as it is about just sort of enjoying the idea of what's to come, you know?
So, Renee, you did this yesterday in a piece for iMore, kind of a thought experiment about what you would like to see next Tuesday for the iPhone 12 announcement. The rumors are there's going to be huge variety, both in colors and sizes. And my general take on that is that's to cover up the fact that we really don't have a lot more we can add to these phones. What do you
think? It's also practical because like the 5G modem, if you look at what other vendors have gone through over the last year, the phone size has increased because especially the millimeter wave, the frequency range 2 modems are just big and power hungry. So they require a lot of resources and the phones get bigger and they're really good about saying our biggest screen ever. But what they really mean is, geez, Qualcomm, can you get this working better, please? And so Apple has to fit that modem into an iPhone, what was an iPhone 11 Pro and Pro Max, and it's going to make it bigger. It looks like they're eating the cost, at least, you know, for the most part. So they're not going to be $100 more expensive like a lot of other phones got this year, but just supplying power to that. And if they are using the next generation of panels, those are more expensive, more power hungry. So I think they realized they had to increase sizes on one side, and they're like, okay, we want to keep the average selling price about the same, so we're going to make a smaller version that's a little bit less expensive, and hopefully that balances everything else and we don't just get crushed by 2020.
So the so-called 12 mini probably would not have millimeter wave.
I think some people have said it would, but I find it hard to believe. It's such a niche technology, such an underdeployed technology, and such an expensive technology that I think it's just reasonable to do what Samsung did, and that's put it in sort of the higher end models and leave frequency range 1, the low and mid band 5G radios, in the lower priced models.
Yeah. Also, in the United States, there's kind of a curveball because Verizon seems to be betting a lot harder on millimeter wave than anybody else. They're trying to make it into a thing for like indoor deployment and for like commercial broadband. I'm wondering what kind of pressure that Verizon is putting on all manufacturers, just saying, yes, I know that the millimeter wave forces you to think about putting a telescoping antenna into your phones for the first time in 40 years. But the thing is, this is the phone that we want to try to sell. So we want you to try to make one.
It's ironic because, as far as I can tell, very few people will be able to get millimeter wave.
And keep it. That's the hard part. Like if you turn around, if you go inside, if it starts raining, if the leaves move on a chair, you lose signal. It's bizarre.
Also, as you mentioned, expense and battery life. It's interesting because Google did put millimeter wave in their Pixel 5, and analysts have said that's the difference primarily between the Pixel 4a 5G and the Pixel 5 is this millimeter wave. $100 it adds to the cost. Mm-hmm. So that's a significant penalty for a capability virtually no one will be able to use.
Yeah, and again, we get back to Verizon because they bought up an enormous amount of millimeter wave spectrum, and they're trying to promote this as this is why our networks are better and this is why we have the fastest, most modern network. Whereas, in terms of subscribers of phones, every other carrier is promoting 5G as something that's going to be very good, very helpful, very important, but not necessarily something they're willing to sandbag a hardware design over. So it's very, you're right.
Verizon has all the Pixel stock too, right? In the US, at least so far.
My sense is this was a deal with the devil that Google had to make. If they wanted Verizon to carry it, they were going to have to put millimeter wave in. They were strong-armed into it. I wonder if Apple was too. Apple doesn't get strong-armed. It just because the problem with millimeter wave is it's so high frequency that it doesn't go through walls well. You really need virtually line of sight to the tower that doesn't
travel. All new towers, too.
Yeah, you need new towers and more of them, four times more of them. So it's only going to be in big cities, probably in high rises, as you said, in inside a business or perhaps
stadiums, maybe. Like, I don't even know if it's going to end up being a commercial technology. I have this huge fear that it'll be like their WiMAX. Like, Sprint was all in on WiMAX and it just didn't work, and it cost them a year and a fortune to get over.
So are we overbuying if we buy a phone with millimeter wave? Are we spending more than we have to?
My big thing about this is that you're getting a Qualcomm modem. And I know for some people, the Intel modems have been just fine. But for a lot of people, especially in borderline areas, they just haven't held a signal as well or as long or as reliably. And even if you never turn on millimeter wave or even, sub-6, sub-7, sub-9, whatever it ends up being, you're still getting a Qualcomm modem for LTE. And for a lot of people, I think that'll be a huge sigh of relief.
Yeah, and on top of all that, it remains to be seen if any of these carriers can deliver 5G services that are in any way relevant to a phone above LTE right now. Every single entity that is involved in streaming or data delivery at high speed, they know how to deliver video and audio to a 4G phone extremely well. And it's not as though we're going to have a phone with an 8K display. If there is one, I bet it's going to be Samsung who makes it, just to say that they were able to make it. But it's hard to figure out how you can deliver 5G to a mobile handset in a way that delivers serious value. Even live streaming, live video streaming and chatting, that's perfectly fine over LTE over phone, given how much data you can throw away because it's not going to be relevant to the needs of that actual application. So people are a little bit surprised with me for buying an LTE phone this year. And one of the reasons that I gave for people is that for me, $350 for a phone this year is a good investment because I'm not going to be dumping $1,000 in a phone that 2 or 3 years from now might not be quite in tune with what the world is like. But also that I don't think that 5G is going to make a big impact on people's lives for another couple of years at least.
So
I've
referred to this before, but the PC Magazine article from last month, Race to 5G, This is they do this yearly. They go to 26 cities. Concluded that 5G was a complete waste of time at this point. And
it's a marketing and finance play.
It's not something anybody should be looking for in a device. That the current leader in 5G speeds is Verizon, but good luck getting anywhere near a Verizon phone. T-Mobile, which has the widest coverage of 5G, their 5G isn't particularly faster. So it really seems like
it's more robust though.
It's 600 megahertz, so it gets through walls. Yeah. It's the low band 5G. I feel like the phone manufacturers, because everybody's putting out 5G phones now.
The aggregation is much better. So instead of having just 20, you know, which limits the amount of people on it, I think it goes up to 100 hertz just on the aggregation. So you can have many more. It's the same tower technology, and you can have just many more people on that tower. So again, it's for those people in those areas who've just always never gotten or been underserved by LTE. And I think T-Mobile is doing a good job with that. The rest is just marketing.
Sasha,
something else that you have to keep in mind, though, is that there, like, not everybody is going to buy a new phone in a couple of years. So there's going to be people buying now with, even though 5G doesn't matter to them at the moment, 5 years from now, they still want their phone to be, you know, as fast as possible. And I agree that from, you know, the phone maker's perspective, phone makers didn't need to make 5G phones yet, but they did. So from the consumer perspective, I would say that it's not a bad idea to just go ahead and buy a 5G phone if you're the kind of person who only buys a phone every 5 or 6 years, because 5 or 6 years from now, 5G is probably going to be more ubiquitous. Maybe not 5 millimeter, but some version of 5G will be used more commonly throughout
But the question
world.
Is, will you be disadvantaged because you're still using an LTE phone? Will you be in a slower network? Will you be on, it will be less?
No.
No. And I don't even think
you will have an older 5G modem, though.
So you're taking a gamble by buying this device that in 3 years 5G will be better, that it will be widespread, that you'll be able to get it. And yes, you raised the excellent point, Renee. You're buying an older 5G technology when you buy it today. So I feel like this is, I mean, it's not a gamble we have a choice in. But if for some reason on Tuesday Apple says these have 5G and these don't and they're $100 less, I would opt for the one without, to be honest.
Some markets might not. Like, there are rumors that outside the big markets are going to have LTE versions, but they're not going to be coming as quickly. And then you just have to deal with, because the problem for consumers here is that before LTE, it was a mess. You had to figure out which network you were on before you could figure out which iPhone you wanted to buy, because you had to have CDMA for Verizon, and those were different models, and for Sprint back then, and the other GSM models. And we got rid of that largely with LTE. You could just buy a phone. If you bought your Verizon, you know, a Verizon phone unlocked, you could use it anywhere. And now you're going to have to pay close attention to which phone goes with your carrier again, which just feels like a step back.
Yeah, well, so the modems like cameras right now, where we don't really have to worry about whether we're going to get a decent one that works, so long as we're not buying a phone in a blister pack at the drugstore. The thing to underscore is that there's a really hot phone that's not available in the United States yet. I'm not going to guess. I have it written down somewhere, but it's so good that a lot of like review sites are importing them just to write a review. And what they have to really remind people of is that because this was designed specifically to be sold in one limited market, they don't have like the full Qualcomm chipset. And so that you'll find that, oh, well, gee, I'm not getting high speed in my area because my carrier because this phone does not support a carrier that does not support a methodology that came across 3 or 4 years ago. It only does like the cheap stuff that isn't really required where this thing was made for. We ignore the great thing about technology when it's mature is that the sign of success is that we totally forget that it exists. And that's what we get when we have like a really mature Qualcomm chipset inside a phone. We forget that those wars have been fought and now we've got the memorials up and we don't have to care about that anymore. As long as we spend any amount of money for a phone, it's going to work on whatever network we have pretty much anywhere in the world.
Speaking of Qualcomm, what is the speculation about? Will there be Qualcomm or Intel radios in these new iPhones, or will it be all Apple silicon?
All Qualcomm.
It will still have Qualcomm.
Apple isn't ready to do a chipset yet. they're working on it. It'll definitely get there. But they're smart enough to say that we are doing great stuff that works great on the Apple campus. It is not ready to inflict upon millions and millions of people that we're taking $1,000 from.
Now, in your fever dream, Renee.
Yes.
This was much more than an iPhone event.
That's a bit prejudiced, yeah. Would you say?
Well, I think when Apple announces a new iPhone, I think their tendency would be to say, look, this is an iPhone event. Well, if we have other things, unless they're directly related.
Usually they have Apple Watch, but they don't this time. Like for the last few years, it's been an iPhone and Apple Watch event.
Yeah, because they're
and
so
last
closely
year, they also had the
related.
iPad.
So
yeah, well, they had the cheap iPad last year as well. So like they have other stuff on occasion. So I was hoping, I need something in 2020, Leo. They've taken all the movies away from me. I have Baby Yoda and I have this. That's all I have left in 2020.
So Renee's fever dream includes, I actually love it, a new, not only a high quality Apple TV 4K Plus, but a little dongle to compete with Google's Chromecast and Fire TV sticks. You call the Apple TV Express. I love this. I hope they do that. That would be great.
They rumored it 2 years ago. The Information had a whole article. And The Information's got a really good track record. They don't do a lot of Apple rumors, but they've got a really good track record when they do. And the rumor was that Apple was working on this as a way to get the Apple TV services onto more screens. Because right now they're already doing it
in TVs, right? So that would indicate to me that it must just be a chip. At best, that they give the TV.
Yeah, it can run on low. Well, the video service can run on low power on the chips that you get in these TVs, but older TVs aren't getting them, and it's only the TV app. Like if you want all the other stuff, like let's say you do want to play Apple Arcade, there's no facility unless you buy an Apple TV, which is expensive.
I get it.
And for me, like they could put something like the latest watch system in package is not as expensive and super powerful, and you could start doing some interesting things. I thought it was one of the things Google did really, really well in that event was. Like as poorly as they sold me on 5G, they sold me really well on the value of making any TV, no matter how old your TV, into a brand new Google TV.
Yeah, except Google's pushing this Stadia gaming server, kind of their version of Arcade, and it doesn't work.
I want
work.
Apple to do that too.
And it doesn't work on the new Chromecast. So it's the two divisions, they built different gauge tracks, and they went,
tried to handshake it.
Just to put a finer point on it, reviewers have sideloaded the Stadia app on it and verified that it does work perfectly. So there's probably a licensing or a business reason why that's not on yet.
That's even more disappointing.
I think they've also said it's early next year. But that does show that, as I said on my Google podcast last week with Flo Ion, that sometimes you get the feeling that Google is being run about as well as an unlicensed nail salon. And this is another
argument. That's an Andy. Actually, there is a good argument that Apple would love to put more AAA titles into Arcade. And to do so, they would really want to get a beefier chip in the Apple TV. Yeah. I would love to see a 12Z or something or a 14. Why not put a 14 into the next Apple TV? Apple certainly could do it, right, Lori?
Definitely. And that's, I can't believe that they haven't actually updated Apple TV in as long as they have, because they're trying to get people on board with Apple Arcade, and they're trying to get people on board with TV Plus, and a brand new Apple TV with the fastest processor you can get, I think that's how you win people over. I got a 4K Apple TV, I think a year ago, and it was because I had been waiting and waiting and waiting for a more updated Apple TV that was more than just Apple TV with 4K. And then I just bought it because I was tired of waiting around. But I would have jumped at a brand new processor, Apple TV. I'd have been very excited by that. And I think that's they need to do that. They need to update it. And Renee's idea of a dongle-based Apple TV, I think, is brilliant. It would be maybe a little more limiting, maybe less space for stuff, maybe less like no app store, maybe just the TV app plus Apple Arcade or something like that. You can get it for super cheap. Those would be great for a lot of people. Like, I have people in my family who don't have Apple TV, but they do have that, they recently bought a new phone. So they have TV Plus, and they don't get to take advantage of the the use on a television set. So they don't watch any of the TV shows. They don't know anything about them because they don't watch it. They can't watch it on their television set. They would have to watch it on their phone. So a new Apple TV that's really inexpensive would definitely bring more people on board to the servicing that they make available, that they're trying to, you know, generate a lot of money from.
My only question about a much more powerful chip inside the Apple TV is, how much overhead are you going to give a user that they're probably never going to touch? I have Android TV at both ends of the spectrum. I have the new Chromecast dongle, $50. Probably could use a little bit more memory, but it works just fine for streaming pretty much everything I've tested on it, all the third-party apps I've tested on it. I also have a $180 NVIDIA Shield, which is more of a console, and it's powerful enough to run. I actually run another media server on it, and it'll run a web browser just fine. The question is, if they decide to put a much faster chip inside the Apple TV, what features are they going to be able to add to it that will make people think, oh, this is why I bought, I spent more money for this version of it instead of the dongle version of it? And I'd really like to know, like, what people would like to have in terms of a more powerful experience beyond tier one games, which I realize is a big thing, but for a lot of people, yeah. They'll have an Xbox One for that.
That's the rumor,
Go ahead, Renee.
No, I was going to say that's the rumor. It was put up by Choco Bits on Twitter, who's, you know, a fairly well-established. I think he works in the Apple secondary supply market. And he said that they were going to do an A14X version because they want to get into higher quality gaming, things like Breath of the Wild. But it raises a couple big questions for me. One is, they do need a more powerful chip because you can see the A10X choke when it starts doing compositing on HDR. It's like just at the edge for that. So mm-hmm. An A12Z for sure. Whether they need an A14X, one thing is Breath of the Wild is a several generations old Nintendo game, which isn't that graphically... Like, they could do that already. They don't really need much more firepower for Nintendo Switch quality games. But also, the market is so different. When you put an AMD system on a chip inside an Xbox or a PlayStation, that's supremely expensive. And they eat that cost because they want to keep prices down and they think they're going to make it up on software, which is the inverse of Apple's model. And an A14X in an Apple TV would be really expensive if Apple just charged cost plus 30%. And I don't know if Apple would eat the cost and keep the price down because they don't make it up on software. They use hardware to subsidize the software. It's completely backwards. So my whole question is, would anybody pay? Apple tried this before we got the Everything is Apps, Apple TV. They were working on a high-end one, and they just thought nobody would pay that much for an Apple TV. And I don't know what's changed about that equation.
Mm. So, Lori, do you want to play Zelda on your Apple TV?
You know she does.
Yeah, I do.
The Switch is such a success. I know what you want to play is Animal Crossing on your Apple TV.
Of course. I'm not going to assume that Apple and Nintendo would come together under one roof. Of course. Yeah. But no, I do think that Apple Arcade is really producing incredible, beautiful, amazing, deep, interesting games. I want Apple TV to be the platform that everybody wants to use it on. I don't want everybody to say, I already got it on my phone. I don't need to play it on my TV. I want people to think of Apple Arcade as a console for your television set, even though it's, you know, in the cloud and you can use it on anything, just because it deserves that kind of attention. These are mobile games, but they're so impressive and creative and beautiful. They deserve to be played on a large screen. So yeah, I want, and again, like Renee is saying, like it's not that it needs it. The Apple TV doesn't need the most advanced chip, but that's what's going to make people want to buy it. But I hear what you're saying, Renee. The cost of the A14 chip on an Apple TV, it would increase the price of Apple TV. People don't even want to pay
the
current price of it. So yeah, they're not going to pay more.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. Google's device is so cheap, their new Chromecast, that if you buy a month of YouTube TV, you get it for free. Yeah. Otherwise, you pay $50. It's cheap. So right. Apple selling a $200 device is already kind of beyond the means of most people. And after all, I guess the real question is, does Apple see Apple TV as a gaming platform, or are they completely content to have the iPhone and the iPad? The iPad is a great gaming experience. You would love Animal Crossing or Zelda on an iPad, right?
Yes.
That would be beautiful.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Not that that's ever
I'd love
happen.
Game Pass on an Apple TV and Stadia on an Apple TV and Amazon Luna on an Apple TV. I just need Apple to get over that. And again, I don't think they're being malicious about it. I just don't think they understand. It's like they have this mental app store, game store model that they just can't see past yet. And when they do and they're like, oh, okay, we get it. Yeah, we want people to have the best experience possible with those services on Apple products. We'll sell all the hardware. Thank you.
Yeah.
Also, the Apple away, TV kids. The Apple TV is the closest thing to tofu that Apple makes. It's this thing that
Wait a minute.
This is a good one. Streaming boxes, they have no identity in and of themselves. They take upon the flavors and the identity of the services that you tie into it. And so if I'm in a Best Buy, really, I'm the most. If I'm an all Apple person, the most vulnerable I could possibly be is to a third-party streaming dongle or streaming box, because it's not really tied into my Apple account all that much, because I'm probably not buying content through the iTunes store anymore. I really want that Apple TV Plus content, but maybe I haven't really gotten into that yet. I'm much more interested in The Mandalorian, which I can get as an app on anything else. So if anything, this is a place where Apple can say that, take the attitude that the purpose of this box is to stream, is to be the most relevant point of access to your computer whatsoever, and that if people are not necessarily doing Apple Arcade, at least Apple still gets the win that when they pick up the remote and wake up their screen, they get a big Apple logo with a landing page of, here is Apple content, here is your Apple Music stream, here are things we're recommending to you, and oh, by the way, here is our voice assistant that has some alerts and some reminders for you. Renee is right in that I don't feel as though there's any downside to Apple making sure that this thing could do as much as possible. Even if they wanted to have like a VNC client to say that, yes, you can use this as a second screen for your Mac, you can use this as a second screen for a Windows machine, anything, just please give us $100 and maybe let us distract you into maybe buying an Apple TV Plus subscription sometime.
AirTags?
God, finally. Please.
if they don't
announce AirTags 1 week from today, they're not going to announce AirTags.
Georgia Dow's going to jump through her screen and just run to Cupertino.
Yeah.
Well, no, the thing is, though, like this, the evidence of AirTags has appeared in coding that might not really matter right now, but to me, it means it will exist. It's just a matter of when. So I don't know. I like saying that if they don't announce it, at this point, they're not announcing it. I'm not sure. I still think it might be on the table. It's just maybe they're
What's
trying to figure
it
out.
Up?
I want it.
Technology.
I want it, Marie.
has it been FCC approved yet? Do they have at least have the radios approved by the FCC?
Oh, that's a good question.
Or the same U1 chip.
I was about to correct myself that if they're using the same chips they're using in other things, they wouldn't need it. But yeah, no, Lori's absolutely right. There's too much evidence that they've got it in the pipeline, but it's like, you're like, not only is this a really interesting idea, this is something that Apple could do flawlessly and with privacy, and I will give you $50 for this. Just point me to the slot where I need to put my 220s and a 10 in. And it's weird.
I mean, there's also the issue with some companies, accusing Apple of monopoly, and like maybe they're just waiting on, you know, a little bit more hearing related stuff before they drop something like this, because they know it's going to cause a lot of controversy.
Yeah, because they announced third party support for the Find My network at WWDC, and this would give those companies 3 months to make competing devices using Apple's own service. And then they could announce the AirTags along. Like Craig could go up and explain how the Find My network works again. And look at all our partners. It's not just AirTags, it's all these things. So stuff at Tile. Here's your competition.
I don't think Apple is the type of company that would say, we don't want to get in trouble with Tile. That doesn't seem like. Look, I'm going to stand by my statement. If they don't release it on Tuesday, then I question their interest in it. You're right. They've put the U1 chip in the watch. They put the U1 chip in the phone. They put the U1 chip. It's in the iPad too, right? It's everywhere.
And the Apple TV remote is supposed to be getting it as well, because that thing is always in sofa cushions, always.
Yeah. So I mean,
if there's anything we lose the most, it's that remote.
Yeah, I would say it's almost as much a sure thing. They'll announce AirTags is that they will announce the iPhone 12. I think this is, it's now or never. And if they don't announce it, there must be some really serious technical.
Maybe they don't think we're going outside, Leo.
It
might be an air power sort of situation where they haven't perfected it yet.
Right.
But since they haven't actually announced it, they don't have to. They don't have to like say, sorry, we're not going to do it anymore, because they never actually announced it. So maybe if they don't announce it next Tuesday, which I really do think they will. Also just don't agree, Leo, that if it's never going to be announced if they don't announce it Tuesday. I think it just means that they're going back to the drawing board and they're still doing some work on it, and that we will see it eventually.
Is it conceivable time. They'll say the watch is the tag?
Buy another watch.
You have to buy
luggage.
A watch for your pet and a watch.
What if you lose your watch? Then you're in trouble. But they have the capability within the ecosystem now to do it without any separate tag. You just couldn't put. You don't want to attach a watch to your keys.
Yeah, exactly.
So I guess there.
I mean, I got two spare. Why not? Right? No big deal.
You know, I was thinking that maybe it's a health and safety thing, because like it does, if the renderings that we've seen are accurate, it does look like a Eucharist wafer. So maybe it's a choking hazard for Catholics. I'm just speculating.
Andre appreciates your concern.
I have no inside information.
I hope they put that label on it.
Dear Padre, please open with caution.
A choking hazard for Catholics and some Episcopalians. Just be careful. Yes. Yeah.
Not meant to be placed on the tongue.
This is not a Eucharist.
This is not the body of Christ.
No.
The event invite. Did you know that there's an AR thing for
it? Yeah, I've been trying to figure out how to do it. So how do I do it? I've got it in front of me, and I've got my phone.
You know, I was not able to successfully do it with the invite.
Oh, you have to do it for the web page. And you probably have to do it with Safari too, right? So I can't do it because I'm not on a Mac.
No, you need it on your. I think you need it on an AR kit device. You need it on an iPhone or an iPad.
Oh, I see. So if I go, but how do I get the invite? Do I go to apple.com on this?
/events.
Go to apple.com/events, and it should just.
This is making that invitation so much less exclusive. I mean, it's on their webpage too.
And your personal invite doesn't even have it, so you're not special at all.
And your name's not even Speed.
Also, I like this AR stuff. It's really, really cool and on trend. But you need to like send me like an Apple logo like event tag that I can hang on my doorknob with all the other event tags. Because otherwise, people don't think that I'm an industry insider.
So how do I turn it on? I'm on the Apple page and stuff.
I think press and hold it.
Press and hold. And now something magical is happening.
Yeah. So then press that little AR thing in the corner. Yeah. And I think in a minute when it loads,
I can put the event invitation on Andy's head.
Yes. If you can get it to work. Yeah.
Totally. Can you, should you?
Oh, look, Andy, they're all coming out. Little
it's a party on Andy's head.
Little invitations. I don't know what's going on.
Can actually switch over to object and it'll just trigger because it doesn't need anything to lay on to show it to you. So you can at least see what it looks like.
Oh, how exciting. It's just a little, Oh, you want to airplay it? I'll airplay it. Let's do that. Ladies and gentlemen, get ready for the most exciting thing that's ever happened in your life. Okay, do it. Will it not do it in AirPlay? Oh, there it goes. Go. Oh, so this is like
You know what? What about AirPod? What are they called? Sorry, HomePod Mini. What do you think?
HomePod Mini.
You know, because that looked like sort of like speaker exploding sound.
Oh.
I just love speculating on it.
Yeah. Yeah, it could be. How do I find the date with my Apple tag?
Maybe those are the cups from the new AirPod Studios, Laurie. All the different colors you can get.
Oh, yeah,
it
yeah.
It is kind of like this molecular thing. Isn't that cool? Let me put maybe, it on my table.
Maybe it's going to be the Apple Silicon announcement, because like they're saying, if you've got like a lot of balls in the air, that our new more powerful CPU will help you keep those balls in the air. I don't know. Okay. What am I doing wrong?
It's happening, but it's not happening.
It's like dark for some reason.
Phone to start. Ugh, stupid AR. Why did anybody think AR?
This is becoming less delightful, Apple.
It's less and less delightful.
If only you had it as glasses and not as a phone.
No glasses.
Yeah, maybe that's what's going to happen. Maybe we'll get AR glasses.
One more thing.
This is kind of dopey. I'm not sold on the AR thing.
Kind of dopey.
You're not wrong.
Right. I just got a thought. What, you know how like Steve was like secretly like live testing the keynote presentation app for months before they actually in front of everybody announced it? What if Tim has actually been like testing Apple Glass like in every single public appearance?
And we just didn't know it. By the way,
wasn't it earlier this year that he was wearing a new pair of glasses that he had that beautiful blue rim glasses? He didn't used to wear that. So maybe
Schiller was wearing glasses in his emoji.
If you remember, it also had that like 8-gauge coaxial cable going from the left temple to a box.
That is so sad. Poor guy gets a new frame and everybody's going crazy over it. By the way,
it looked so good on him. The new glasses that he was wearing, I think it was it? I don't even remember what event it was. It could have been WWDC, but it might have been before that. They just looked so good on him. So
that poor guy on TikTok has to upgrade now. He can't just keep doing his "Good morning from Cupertino" TikToks without that.
I'm speaking seriously now. This is the first time this thought has occurred to me, that the stakes for like an Apple wearable, Apple glasses, are very, very high, because Tim wears glasses like a lot of us on this panel. We wear glasses. And if they try to sell these with the point of view that, hey, these aren't just like something you'll just put on for gaming, or you just put on for, you'll want to actually, they're so natural and so lightweight, you'll want to wear them all the time. Tim can afford to like have an Apple Watch on his wrist every single time. He can afford to like have an iPhone in his pocket every single time. But are they really going to release these until Tim can say, "Wait, Tim, I noticed that you're not wearing your Apple glasses. Why aren't you wearing your Apple glasses if they're so great? If the Apple glasses, if you don't want to be without them, Apple glasses."
I do have
why,
to
Tim,
point
aren't
out
you wearing your Apple glasses
that
now?
The glasses Jaws is wearing look very similar. And if you aim your iPhone at his shirt, it will explode.
You can see a horse.
You can see a horse. Those are
the. He tweeted a photo of his iPhone screen today, and everyone's like, "Those bezels look too thin. That notch looks too small." It's like, no, Josh doesn't leak on Twitter.
Yeah, he's had experience at this. He knows not to do that.
So I should mention that yesterday was the 9th anniversary of the passing of Steve Jobs in 2011, and Tim Cook did. Post a beautiful tweet. A great soul never dies. It brings us together again and again. Maya Angelou, you're always with us, Steve. Your memory connects and inspires us every day. And Steve is definitely not wearing augmented reality glasses. I can tell you that right now.
he's already seeing 8 years into the future.
Yeah, he sees the future. Yeah, he sees the future through those glasses. Let's take a little break, and we will talk more about what is to come a week from today. Also, some security news about the T2 chip that's worrying me just a little tiny bit.
Maybe news.
Maybe not. We'll see. Our show today brought to you by ExtraHop. You should be worried if your business is in the cloud these days, right? The new IT reality, remote access on a massive scale. All workers are going home, right? Rapid cloud and multi-cloud adoption. Of course, a steady increase in Internet of Things devices. All on top of a rise in cybercrime. In a post-compromised world, it's more important than ever that organizations see everything going on in their environment, from the cloud to the data center to the customer. But in order to prevent an incident from becoming a full-scale data breach, you need more than unified visibility. You need the context for detections so that you can respond intelligently. You need workflows so teams can collaborate easily and act quickly. And all of that is what ExtraHop gives you. ExtraHop, it stops breaches 70% faster by eliminating blind spots. It's really a view into your entire network, how it's performing, where the threats are. It's cloud threat detection and response. It's security and IT tool consolidation. It detects threats other tools miss to keep your business secure and available. ExtraHop is a SaaS-based cloud-native network detection and response tool that is beloved by its customers. Just ask Dan McDaniel. He's a chief architect and information security officer at Wizards of the Coast. They use AWS, and of course, they secure it and support it with ExtraHop. Dan McDaniel said there's no other company that aligns to supporting the DevOps model, the speed and the lack of friction, than ExtraHop. There you see Ulta Beauty. They use ExtraHop to secure their Google Cloud. And of course, because they have branches all over the world, they keep networking and security teams on top of things so engineers can focus on innovation and know that their network is secure. John Kreese, senior IT engineer at Ulta, says, before ExtraHop, we had limited visibility into what was going on in the cloud, but now we can quickly identify vulnerabilities and exploits and understand how our applications are performing in the cloud. So it's both, really. It's performance and it's threat detection. It's something you really need, you really want. And if you want to know more, including how ExtraHop detects Ripple 20 vulnerabilities, that's on everybody's mind right now. Learn more about how ExtraHop stops breaches 70% faster. There's a great free trial waiting for you and a demo, too. You'll really like how it looks. I think you'll really enjoy it. ExtraHop.com/twit. ExtraHop.com/twit. Please use that URL. Let them know you saw it here. And we thank ExtraHop so much for supporting MacBreak Weekly. Sometimes, you know, these cloud security companies, these enterprise companies say, oh, Apple people aren't interested. But ExtraHop knew there are a lot. I know there are a lot of you listening responsible for giant networks. So we thank you for supporting us and ExtraHop at the same time. On we go with the show. Didn't mean to bring you down with that Tim Cook tweet, but I thought it was worth.
No,
well, that's right.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I will never forget that day. We were doing a triangulation. And it was with somebody who had worked with Steve, Kevin Marks. That's right. He'd worked at Apple on QuickTime. And we got the news, horrible news. Kevin, thank goodness, was there. We broke and we just did a lot of coverage. I think we must have done 7 or 8 hours of nonstop remembering Steve coverage. It was really good. So a researcher has claimed that the T2 security chip, which is in the latest models, is in my iMac Pro. It's in the Mac Pro. It does a lot. It's more than just a security chip, but it also, you know, is the disk controller and a lot more. It is your secure enclave. It's your secure boot. Security researcher Niels Hoffman says because it's based on an A10 processor, it's vulnerable to the same Checkmate exploit. That's the one you may remember that allowed people to jailbreak the iPhone. So, should I be worried, Renee Ritchie?
No, what was interesting to me is that Will Strafik, who's a really well-known security researcher, he does really probably the best VPN client on the market, does a lot of privacy research. He woke up, looked at the news coverage and said, oh my God, what is happening here? It's something to, I don't know what the right way to put it. The disclosure wasn't great and the reporting wasn't great. It is something, but it's not something that people should worry about yet. And if you go through @Chronic on Twitter, he's done a really good breakdown on all of this. And the CheckRain developer just weighed in.
You would need physical access to the device, right? You have to,
yes,
you have to do a DFU.
Unclear.
You have to have a failed, if you have a fatal error in the DFU, they're using a vulnerability. You have to jump in.
You have to inject a payload probably through a USB device that's but
so
it doesn't
if somebody
even say
stole
that it works.
Your like, iMac, we don't know. Maybe.
But again, like the beginning part is okay, but there's no proof that this actually you need, in order for this to work, it needs to sustain a reboot, and there's no actual evidence it does that. So it's not even a known working exploit. It's just a blog post.
It's just a potential.
And the CheckRain, the CheckRain developer just wrote that people should really chill down. I haven't heard that one before. Chill down regarding this exploit. The vulnerability has been public for more than a year now, and always has been there on the T2. Moreover, there are plenty of other vulnerabilities, including remote ones, that undoubtedly have more impact on security.
Well, yes. You know, if there's a remote vulnerability to the T2, I'd like to know about that one.
Yeah, but so the big part about this is that it's not known to actually work yet. It's something that some people are reporting on and amplifying over and over again. And we know that you can jailbreak the T2 chip because it really is an A10 chip. But there's no proof that it subsists after that. And there's no proof that anything else along the exploit chain works yet.
You wouldn't necessarily gain any advantage. You just jailbroke it.
Yeah, well, I mean, if it reboots and it goes back to normal, then there's no real there. It's just like if they happen to have your computer for an extended period of time, like a nation state or like, you know, a federal agency, you know, maybe they could use this to pull some data off every time they get in before they reboot. But it's really unclear how damaging it is.
Here's the question. If I'm using File Vault, would it allow them to decrypt my File Vault encryption?
Not immediately. And it's not proven that they could sustain long enough to get the keys off of the machine, even if they got in.
Because that's the only thing that would scare me. If they got into the machine, fine. But if they could, they need to decrypt my file. And everybody uses File Vault now with a T2. It's on by default. So they would need to be able to decrypt that encrypted volume before they get into anything. And they have to
there's a threat on that too.
Yeah. All right. So I'm not saying panic.
They haven't investigated the design yet to see if there's enough there to extract the keys. And these are the smartest InfoSec people in the world.
Okay.
I wish the press would really talk to them before hitting publish. It would just save us all so much.
Well, you know what?
Like my mom asking me.
We talk to you so that you can tell us on their behalf.
That's the first thing I do. And also to Lori's credit, like her writers, they had a huge discussion about this morning, and we're going over all of this. It's just, it behooves everybody.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. To be fair, this is part of a discussion that we didn't have to have 5 or 10 years ago. We could almost dismiss these sort of let's assume that this is one of the hacks that actually works and is practical. We used to be able to sort of dismiss a lot of these warnings with, oh yeah, but this person to be effective, someone would actually have to have physical access to your phone, and that doesn't make it completely irrelevant. But that means okay, so we don't have to think about it. But now in the environment that we're in right now, the idea of, oh well, there was a protest and a law enforcement officer took my phone away, or I was at a security checkpoint at an airport in another country, and once again they took my laptop. They wanted me to hand over my phone for 10 minutes. Now it becomes more important to be aware of what kind of tools might be in the arsenal of some organization that might want to slurp all your information out of your phone, or in more intense cases might want to put some software on your phone that you would not really approve of. Whereas the iPhone used to be the phone where I don't feel as though I need to automatically factory reset my phone before handing it over to somebody. It might become more relevant to think that I'm not going to take the chance. It becomes more important than just simply someone trying to brute force a passcode right now. And that's something that people at least need to be aware of.
You might want a T2 chip if you like to watch Netflix, because I guess you won't be able to watch Netflix in 4K without a T2 chip. So that means you have to have really a pretty late model MacBook Pro, MacBook Air, Mac Mini. If you have a Mac Pro or an iMac Pro, you'd be okay. You have to have the new iMac. The T2 chip is fairly recent.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So that's important. Apple does have
an SSD controller, and the iMacs weren't all SSD until this year.
Oh, yeah. Well, there you go.
It doesn't work on platters.
Yeah.
Where do you think this demand came from? Do you think it came from Netflix directly, or from content providers providing stuff to Netflix?
Well, of course, Netflix probably doesn't care. But I'm sure they are enjoined by their contracts with movie companies to make sure that they, because they're terrified. You know, Hollywood's terrified of piracy, that there's no way to pirate Netflix video. It's interesting because you still would get the 1080p, you just wouldn't get the 4K version.
It also, the performance is way better because depending on the codec they use, you get up to 30 times speed boosts from using the T2 chip to decode.
So maybe it's really a performance, not a security thing. Maybe it's just performance.
It's probably both. I mean, I'm sure they're wrapping it up as tight as can be so that, you know, there's no casual. Anyone who wants it will still get it, but there'll be no casual piracy.
There's no way to stop you from playing it on your iMac and videotaping it with your camcorder.
It's ridiculous. Like, you can't even take a screenshot on your iPhone of a movie anymore. Yeah. And people would share that. They'd meme that. It would be so much fun.
So
and they shut it down to a point where it's ludicrously bad for them.
Yeah, they're just so
scared. Not only that, but it's part of the ongoing assault on fair use doctrine and copyright. They've locked things down so tight that it becomes, we do have the right of fair use for copyright, but guess what? Let's say that if I'm going to make a review or even a political statement regarding a documentary, I can't use an 8-second clip from there because it will get content struck completely immediately. And so what's the point of us having the ability to take a frame from a movie and use that as a way of illustrating a point or increasing the conversation about this subject if we can't even grab one frame from a movie by doing a screenshot? Unless these people think that I can screenshot at 30 frames per second and then put it into Premiere and reconstruct the movie, it's just not acceptable.
You probably really can't watch Terminator 2 without a T2 chip, I would guess.
Good one, Leo.
be sure to use your liquid metal SIM extractor.
Oh yeah, remember that? Oh,
well That's played, cut. Andy.
They had liquid metal for the longest time, and the only thing they ever made was a SIM tool. What the hell?
Yep.
That's something that should always ground us. We're talking about rumors, and it's a fun thing. It's a fun broad subject. That they've got these patents on liquid metal, and what could they do with this technology in an iPhone case? And really, that's the only thing we ever saw that used that metallurgical technology was this little thing you could pick your teeth with or extract a SIM with.
And frankly, it's not that much different than just a non-liquid metal thing.
Unbent paper
clip. It's not like it feels
very, very
special
very
or anything.
Yeah.
I have liquid metal. What you won't have if you go to the Apple store is Bose, Sonos, or Logitech headphones. They've all disappeared from the Apple store.
Bum, bum, bum. What does that mean?
We need Enola Holmes, Leo. We need Enola Holmes on this case immediately. Yeah.
Is it foolish to say that implies that Apple's perhaps Studio, what do they call them? Studio Airs?
AirPod Studio.
There's a lovely picture of I don't know where you got this model, Renee, of some gorgeous woman wearing her. Wait a minute, those are Beats. Never mind.
Well, the Beats are being supplanted
by the even
pros.
Through the screenshot.
If the AirPod Studio looked kind of like Beats, I would be so happy. But you've seen the renders of the supposed leaks, right?
No. Are they over the ear?
I don't like the way they look.
Are they on the
ear? Yeah, they're over there.
They're over the ear.
They're very plain. I'm like,
old-timey,
would
you say old-timey?
Maybe in real life it'll look better.
They're like rounded. They aren't round. They're rounded rectangles with wire work. It looks almost like a Braun made a set of headphones.
Right. It's very simple and not my style. Like if I'm going to wear a big old thing over my head, I want it to be pretty cool looking. And it reminds me of something that maybe was popular in the 70s in that sort of like your dad
like
has
Doctor
this
Who.
Like. It had, you know, like your dad has this amazing entertainment center that he uses these like big studio quality looking headphones. It's like, yeah, I mean, okay.
You're not allowed to touch, even though you promise you're going to be really, really careful with it. And you're only going to,
right. Yeah, which by the way, I have those headphones that my dad wouldn't let me touch as a kid in my closet. I got them from him as an adult.
One of the few things that I absolutely insisted that I get from like my parents' house when they passed away, we shut everything down is I want dad's camera kit because look who's holding the camera now.
Oh really? So you both feel like slighted because dad wouldn't let you. I'm trying to think what it was. I wouldn't let my kids do. They couldn't look at my Playboys, that's for sure.
But like you didn't have any kind of technology that you like they were not allowed to touch because you were worried they were gonna mess it up.
No, because you know, I'm a little less precious about technology because I have so much of it, right?
Yeah.
It's not, it's like, oh, you can't touch that
iPad. Mustang. It's too, the Mustang.
No, I let Henry drive the Mustang. Yeah. I even let him drive the Tesla. Here's the ugly pictures from Prosser of the
Air. I mean, they're it's really, not that they're ugly. They're just very plain
It looks
looking.
Like you're wearing Altoid tins on your
but
ears.
But you can supposedly change out the head, the earmuff parts for different colors and looks and the under the...
Yeah.
Can I just point out...
They're probably all magnetic.
In a year from now, we'll look at these and go, God, why don't all headphones look this good?
I know we got used to.
I know
we got used to the AirPods. They were made fun of to no end, and now people are just used to them, and they're even like you know sought after the design itself. So that's true. I guess I just really wanted it to be fun, and I should have known that Apple is you know there's such. You know, their design aesthetic is not garish. So I should have assumed that they were going to be a little bit more demure about the style. But I was hoping it would be kind of a, I don't know, something.
Yeah.
I don't know. I get it.
If they're really competing with higher end headphones, that's the aesthetic of like $300, $400, yeah. $500 headphones. There's a point
exactly.
at which they're it says, oh, this is class. See, we would put more stuff on it if we were just trying to give you something that has thumpy, 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 thumpy bass. No. These are studio monitors.
Well,
you know, I'm slapping stickers all over mine though.
Mr. Prosser also suspects it won't just be AirPod Studio headphones on Tuesday, but maybe new HomePod speakers.
Mini.
Perhaps a HomePod like Mini.
A little baby version.
Google's getting excellent reviews for their little mini Google Voice speakers. People say it sounds very good for the size. It's fabric covered. It's a lozenge.
It's all about algorithms now, Leo. We're transcending atoms, and the bits are taking over. We're doing things beyond what the physical. It's so weird.
A lot of it is about hitting the sweet spot, where that's what a lot of the I do have one. It sounds really nice, but what really struck me is that I also have like the what was originally the $400 Google Home Max, and it's very good. But this is and I realized that this new $99 speaker was released a few years later, so we're seeing technologically advantages.
Oh, don't tell me it sounds as good as the Max.
No, it doesn't sound as good as the Mac, but what I'm getting at is that it's hits the sweet spot of do people want to spend $800 for a pair of stereo speakers? No, they don't. Do they want to spend $200 for a pair of stereo speakers? Yes. And if these sound as good as like a $400 or $500 set, boy, that's a huge win, particularly when you consider that you can buy one of these for $99 to just be your little office streaming music thing. But then as time goes by, you find yourself adding a second and a third and a fourth for not only to increase the presence of music in your house, but also to pair these things up. And that's where I think it's really good design. And that's where I certainly hope that Apple decides to look at where the market has gone for smart speakers over the past 3 or 4 years and decide that perhaps a single $400 speaker that we can then do lots of videos about with camera tracking moves and talk about dynamic range isn't as valuable as something that people will actually buy because it sounds really good. There's enough volume, there's enough presence, and they can actually afford it. And I mean, it's.
They have to change the vision, though.
I'm shocked
that
Apple hasn't done anything with the speaker since then. That's all.
So, like, the original is like the thing that keeps getting me is that Apple started the HomePod project 5 years before we saw it. And the whole goal was you don't have any audio in the room. You're supposed to be able to walk in, drop this little box, and no matter where you drop it or where you stand, it'll give you great sound throughout the entire room. And then they're like, oh, it has no screen. I guess we'll just use Siri for it. And it took them so long to develop that this entire home speaker market, home assistant market took off. And suddenly, like, the assistant part was the thing everyone cared about. And they brought a $500 speaker to a home assistant, to $100 home assistant fight. And by reducing it, they are basically removing everything that they originally thought that product should be, because a small HomePod mini is not going to fill a room no matter where you put it. And I don't know if they just bite that bullet and say, okay, it's just going to be a speaker. And if you want to fill a room, you can buy three of them or two of them or whatever. But it feels like that this is something where they have to apply that. Second generation, we learned so much. And give people more of the product they wanted than the product Apple initially sought out to create.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Go ahead.
I think the HomePod Mini idea is an absolute genius idea as a companion to a HomePod. So I've got the two HomePods paired to my television set. They are my stereo audio for my television set. But I also have...
Does that work pretty well?
There's a lot of times where it drops out and you have to reconnect the pods. And I have not figured out reason why that would keep happening. It's really easy to repair it. You just, find it in your little AirPlay thing when you press and hold the home button. It's easy to repair it, but it drops off of pretty much every single app. Every time I turn on the television, I have to repair them. So
that's
it's a little frustrating.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
it's more frustrating.
Yeah.
They should just have a setting unless you make it permanent. Like, I want to dedicate these HomePods to this TV.
You would think that that's what's happening. Like, I don't know. There's always been something technologically wrong with the way the HomePods pair with the television set. It should be that they are the default always connected pods. That's the way it's set up, right?
Does the same thing happen with the AirPods? Because I had a caller on the radio show complaining about that.
I don't use headphones with my television set, so I can't speak to that. Right. I don't know how well or poorly that connection works. Right. But my point was about the HomePod Mini, though. I would love to have another speaker in the kitchen and another speaker in the office and another speaker in the bedroom, just to have them, that they're not part of my stereo setup for my HomePods. Another reason I don't use my HomePods for music very often, because I keep hoping that they're not going to disconnect from my television set, so I don't mess with that. But if I have a bunch of little ones around the house that I can connect my phone to, or I can just announce that I want to listen to something, I am on board with that. I would love to have a bunch of less expensive, less high quality speakers for smaller areas. And then the two HomePods that I have set up for my Apple television, my Apple TV, they can stay isolated to the living room. And even though it's a pain in the butt, I'm telling you, I have never heard home stereo audio sound as good as it does with this HomePods. And just like was Renee is saying, like, it sends these things out in this beautiful room filling way that it's amazing that it can do it. Sometimes there'll be like a movie where a chirp or a sound takes place to the left of the movie, and it'll startle me because I thought I just heard something in the other room because it's so clearly coming from that side of the room, So they're really good.
Have you tried the spatial audio on the AirPods Pro, Lori? I've been waiting to hear you talk about it. It's so mind-boggling.
How does that? Why is this happening? That's what I do. It's just, how is that even possible? It's amazing.
Yeah. I think the underlying lesson to all of this is that it's great to have like best in class audio quality, but that's not necessarily what's going to cause the greatest customer satisfaction. It's so great to hear you talk about, Lori, how you're using these speakers, because obviously, like I said, I've got Google Home Max. My whole idea was that I'm going to pair up these speakers and that's going to be like my bedroom speakers, because I don't necessarily want to have I don't want to have an amplifier. I don't want to have all this stuff. I just want really, really good sound, and they sound great. But you talk again, getting back to the idea of Google being run like an unlicensed nail salon, so that I have an Android TV TV dongle, okay? Google Chromecast, which is made by the same company that does Android TV. These Google Home Max speakers, which work with Google Chromecast and were also made by the same company that made the Chromecast and the Android TV. Guess what? I can't simply tell the Android TV, hey, please use these Chromecast speakers as your default pair of speakers. You can't do it. The only way I could do it is by turning it into a Bluetooth speaker, and I can't do that as a stereo set. And like, that is such the dumb, I was so disappointed by that. And it's so great to, and it's like.
Same thing is happening on the Apple end. It's a disconnect that it should work. It's not that they didn't include that. It's that whatever the connection is, it's just not, it doesn't work. It just keeps falling out. So yeah, it's not a Google thing. It happens everywhere. Apple is bad at it too.
I had the same sort of problems with these speakers where they would drop off or they would just suddenly disconnect or something stupid would happen like that. Have you ever tried like factory resetting both of them to sort of force both of them to do like a firmware update at the same time? Because that was the only thing that solved my drop off problems with my Google Home stuff.
I like this idea. I think I'm going to go do that right after this episode. I could definitely, for some reason, the volume will sometimes turn up and down on my HomePods while I'm watching a movie, just randomly. Yeah. I like to pretend that it's because I have a ghost, but it's really
you have an Apple product. Yeah. I have to say, the biggest problem I have with our HomePod, it's near our TV, is that for some reason, Shlomo just thinks everything's about her. And constantly
so
wakes
thirsty.
Up. Yeah, constantly is waking up saying, what, huh? What? Yeah, I don't
they
know
said what you're seriously, about. And like sometimes it's like nothing. It's like nothing approaching the trigger word was said. Like, what are you even doing?
Seriously How is one word you? That triggers it. I'm sorry if I triggered any of you at home. But that's one reason I would also be hesitant to use a HomePod as a TV speaker. I guess what we ended up doing, and I'm sure you must do this, is we tell it not to pay any attention to the trigger word, right?
You can. I don't do that.
And you don't have that problem?
It used to be pretty bad, but now, I mean, it used to happen daily and more often than daily at some point.
After
but now
all this, I can't believe you're still using these as your TV speakers. This is just a nightmare.
I don't have any other TV speakers, so I would have to listen through my television set, which is terrible.
We should get her some speakers. Speaking of Siri, we're going to take a little time out and then talk about that. I did want to mention, and I hope this isn't going to be upsetting to you, Eddie Van Halen has passed away at the age of 65. He had throat cancer, so it was not unexpected, but still, he's very young.
An absolute innovator. Yeah. There was a reason why he often did not let himself be videoed or photographed facing the camera because he wanted to protect his technique.
That's wild. I didn't know that. Wow. Yeah.
So good.
Anyway, so a moment of silence. This episode of MacBreak Weekly is brought to you by Worldwide Technology, a.k.a. WWT. It's one of the top technology solution providers in the world, delivering business and technology outcomes to large private and public organizations all over the globe. WWT is in the business of digital transformation, and you couldn't find a better partner to help you make that transformation, especially if you're looking to adopt a multi-cloud architecture. That's a challenge. I think everybody understands that the cloud's the future. People are reluctant, though, to put all their eggs in one basket, so multi-cloud is very appealing, but you've got to have a partner that really understands it, the pitfalls, the ways to do it that are safe, secure, effective, and that's what WWT is there for. They stay with you every step of the way from your initial cloud vision, planning the strategy, to cloud enablement, migration, to optimization and management, and everything in between. And that's where you want the expertise. Their cloud consultants will sit down with you to formulate that vision and the strategy. And they know that, and by the way, this is really important. You might talk to other people who don't understand this. The investment pays off only to the degree that it aligns with your business goals. You don't do cloud just because it's cloud. It's got to fit your needs, your goals. And that's where WWT really is fantastic. Through briefings and workshops, they already help some of the world's largest organizations unravel the complexities of the cloud to unlock business opportunities. They're experts in cloud migration and application development. They can create a secure landing zone in any cloud with on-demand labs. And their beautiful ATC, their Advanced Technology Center, that give organizations access to tools for things like microservices, cloud-native development. Once you're up in the cloud, WWT helps you manage it, optimize it. Because cloud, frankly, it's a continuum. You don't just do it and forget about it. It requires constant attention to detail. That's where WWT can help. Whether your strategy calls for a cloud-native, hybrid cloud, or on-prem resources, WWT is there for you. They work closely with Intel to optimize for the latest cloud smart solutions based on Intel technology for security, performance, and agility. And of course, when you say Intel, you gotta mention the Intel Optane persistent memory. Really impressive technologies. Other great Intel technologies, workload optimized to deliver affordable, large capacity and data persistence for solutions supporting everything from VDI to data analytics. You need to learn more. Go to wwt.com/twit. Find out how organizations across all industries all over the world turn to WWT to guide them on the cloud journey. And while you're there, create a MyWWT account. That'll give you the access to the entire ATC ecosystem. That Advanced Technology Center is a eighth wonder of the world. Put $500 million of enterprise gear in there so that you can try it out. WWT.com/twit. WWT, delivering business and technology outcomes all over the world. Thank you, WWT. So I want to actually, speaking of Siri, I want to talk a little bit about Neil Seibert's article. We love Above Avalon, his blog, and Neil is a great innovator, and he, or a great analyst, I should say. He talks a little bit about, he's talking about the Apple Watch. He's talking a little bit about, and I fell for this back a few years, where everybody said the next big category is going to be these speakers that you can talk to, the Amazon Echo, the Google Voice. Nobody said that about the HomePod, but you know, the same idea. And he says, you know,
Cortana.
Even then, he called it the stationary smart speaker mirage. He said the smart speakers, and this is in 2017, so he was very astute. He says smart speakers end up competing with a seemingly unlikely product category, wearables. And in fact, that's what Apple's always said, is that we really, or I guess Johnny Ive really said, This is where Shlomo should live, is in your Apple Watch on your wrist, not
on
some
near field versus far field debate.
Some stationary speaker somewhere, and Neil's taking a little victory lap because it's pretty clear that Apple Watch is a massive success. He estimates 35% of U.S. iPhone owners wear an Apple Watch, more than a third. He says,
that's just going to keep growing too.
Yeah, I think you're right.
Mm-hmm. 75%
this year, especially
last year. Yeah.
So that means 81 million people wearing an Apple Watch as at the end of June. 75% going to first time customers.
I love how grumpy he gets. Like, he gets so angry because, like, he'll see an article in The Verge where they're like, oh, the Amazon Echo is selling so well. Oh, the Apple Watch is beleaguered. And he's like, the Apple Watch sold 18 times more. What is the matter with you? Data. Look at data. There are numbers here.
He says that.
Or the Wall Street Journal. He'll go crackers.
In 2020, almost as many people will have bought their first Apple Watch as the entire Fitbit customer base. Apple Watch install base is increasing by the size of Fitbit's overall install base every 12 months. Here's the graph, and that sure looks like it's linear, but it looks like pretty strong growth year over year. Now, Apple does not release these numbers, so these are based on his own calculations. Then he also, and we've talked about this before, he also mentions, but I think this is pretty astute, the grand unified theory of Apple products. So at the top, the Mac Pro push the boundaries of a computer. Right below it, the MacBook Pros handle tasks formerly given to Mac desktops. Right below it, iPads handle tasks formerly given to the Mac. Right below it, iPhone handle tasks formerly given to the iPad and the Mac. Right below that, Apple Watch, AirPods handle tasks formerly given to the iPhone. Does that seem like an accurate portrayal?
That's the Phil Schiller diet. Like, Phil Schiller has this incredibly famous slide that he used to keep internal, but Apple put it up a couple times as a graphic. They even made a shirt out of it. You can get a shirt with it on sometimes at Apple. But he has this thing, the Schiller doctrine, which says that every product has to push against the next highest up product. So it's literally the job of the Apple Watch to push the iPhone, the iPhone's job to push the iPad, the iPad's job to push the Mac, and then those products' jobs to push back in order to prove why they still need to exist.
Oh, I like that.
And that's how he was driving the teams in marketing, was like, you have to eat the functionality of whatever is the next best device. And then when he would tell the other people, you better not let them catch up, or there's no reason to keep you around.
It's worked. Yeah. It's a virtuous circle, that's for sure. It's worked very well. I'm not sure I'd call it a flywheel. It's not quite a flywheel. It's more like the bigger fish, eats the little fish, eats the littler fish, eats the littler
fish. It's what happened with watches, right? Like we had huge watchtowers in town square. Then we had grandfather clocks in our living room. And then we had bedside clocks. And then we had pocket watches. And then finally we had watches on our wrists. It's what happens with technology. And Apple's doing a really good job of replicating that with computers, but taking it the next step. And now we have computers in our ears. We have 10 core audio processing units in our ears, which is just a silly amount of compute power for something that small.
Yeah, I have to say that I think that explanation that he offered was a little shaky and definitely not unique to Apple. I think that it is the nature of innovation to say, here is a really popular product. What is it not doing well? And what's frustrating the hell out of people about it? And is there a need that we can fill with something brand new? It's not so much a case of a linear, this product is taking away functionality from this, doing the jobs that we were used to doing with this. This next product, next step down on the line is taking away features that were being previously handled by this. It's really is that we are all devoted to $1,500 laptops. And the thing is, a $1,500 laptop was always overkill for at least half of what we needed it for. And so that's why cheaper laptops started coming out. And that's why the iPad was so popular, because we needed something lightweight. That's why smartphones, both pre-iPhone and post-iPhone, became a big deal, because we didn't really want to carry a laptop with us at all times. And even if there's Wi-Fi everywhere, we just want this couple of important features that is relevant to us in our pockets. We want to have that working. So I just don't think of it as a... It's definitely not an Apple doctrine. Definitely not. And I suspect that it gets shakier and shakier the more you pick apart this analogy. And also, it's always the history of technology on all levels is fascinating on every single level. And Renee came up with a good point. It's like, there was a reason why we used to have village and tower clocks. It's because there needed to be a standard by which people knew what time it was. When we didn't have, there was a wonderful question that made me feel both delighted and completely old. There was a no stupid questions subreddit on Reddit, somebody who's clearly very young saying, well, how did people like know what time it really was before phones that could automatically say, and Wi-Fi, and he wasn't asking like how do people know what time it was? It was like, how did you set your clock? When you got a brand new clock and plugged it in, how did you know what time it really was? Instead of like guessing within 5 or 10 minutes, and there had to be this discussion of you used to be able to call the sundial lady. you call a phone, when villages used to run off of here is a bell that sounds at a certain time of day, whether it's in the church or the sound of the tone, right?
At the sound of the tone, the time will be 1 p.m.
Yep.
And then we suddenly had the locomotive, and we needed a way to actually know what time it was, a really critical timekeeping device that was portable, sailing ships that needed to crack the problem of how do we keep accurate time no matter where we are, because that's the only way we're going to be able to navigate. All these things that are – it's not just, gee, I really wish that clocks were more convenient. It becomes, no, here's something that was enabled by a advent of technology that solves a problem that always existed. We just didn't know – it's always fun as a designer to have your sketchbook of fantasy products, pieces of technology you develop. If we only had the resources, it's wonderful when you get to the point where actually it turns out that the iPhone comes out and multi-touch displays become reliable and affordable, and suddenly you're going back to those sketchbooks you filled in design school about what would a phone look like if we didn't have to have any physical buttons on it, and what could that phone do if it like, and well, there you go.
There is an argument though that like, I think, you know, for a while Microsoft had that problem where they were so, especially in the Ballmer years, they were so beholden to Windows that they would kill anything innovative in the company that challenged it. Like they would never scale Windows Phone up. They would never allow them to do things like the courier. Just so many things died, and Apple institutionally figured out a way around that problem, around those little petty fiefdoms.
But that's the risk of having that. You got to defend against the other guy. You're starting to pit product lines against each other a little bit, right? You have to really watch it to make sure.
They're happy for them to cannibalize.
Yeah.
their internal cannibalization is fine, and some companies don't like that either.
Yeah. I mean, and perhaps it's upsetting because there are people who say, you know, the Macintosh is becoming too much like the iPad, And
or the iPhone killed the iPod. You know, better the iPhone than something else.
Well, I don't mind. No one's complaining that the iPod was killed by the iPhone.
Well, probably Tony Fadell.
Maybe Tony.
He doesn't seem so happy.
Yeah.
But though, like Renee's point is true, though, nobody's complaining about the iPhone killing the iPod because we have the iPhone. But what if it was another music thing that killed the iPod that wasn't owned by Apple? Then they would be, oh no.
Yeah,
so
right.
The fact that the
or iPhone Tony killed the iPhone.
Better iPod we kill good. Our own. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, 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 exactly.
And letting Tony's iPod department kill the iPhone before it ever came out.
He also, Seibert quotes Tim Cook, who said in 2019, I believe if you zoom out into the future and you look back and you ask the question, what was Apple's greatest contribution to mankind? It will be about health. And this is where the Apple Watch seems to really be getting gear, you know, getting into traction.
Yeah.
Health is obviously, and despite the problems with the blood oxygen and all that stuff, it's still the pretty much the most amazing health device.
Yeah,
out there, right? I mean, I haven't tried a Fitbit in a while, but and I know people love their Fitbits.
It's the most comprehensive, best health wearable. It's not that individually it has more sensors or works better, but the combination of all the things that it has combined with the software that lets you understand and share that information with your doctors, that's what makes it the most important contribution to society, I think, is that it helps us understand our health. You can participate in studies that are based around the sensors that are in the Apple Watch. So you can join studies where you can track your blood oxygen, you answer these questions. These are all part of things that will inevitably in the future help doctors and scientists better understand our bodies in order to provide the right kind of care and treatments for us. So this is all of this is all part of what Apple Watch is doing. So I hands down 100% agree. Again, another reason why I think Apple Watch needs to be platform agnostic. I don't mean family setup. I mean an Android user all by themselves can go buy an Apple Watch and use it, and it works really well, and there's a health app for Android. I want all of that because I think everybody should have the opportunity to be able to have that kind of technology.
I think Apple's point of view is, well, if that's so important, then Android Wear should be better. That, you know, like you guys need to do a better job if you want to.
I think they just can't make it independent yet. Like eventually they want it to be like an iPhone where you don't have to have any other device. Like the iPhone used to be tethered to iTunes and you had to have a Mac or PC to use your iPhone. And then it got technologically sound enough that they could untether it. And now you just can buy an iPhone. And I think step by step, year over year, we're getting there. It's just it's a way more constrained device. But in a year or two, I fully expect they'll have an Apple Watch event and say, in this year, the Apple Watch is fully independent, can stand on its own. If all you want is an Apple Watch, go buy an Apple.
And that's a good thing for Apple. Why? Because they would sell more watches?
I don't know. I don't care whether it's good for Apple. I think it's good for humanity.
Yeah, but Apple cares. I know. I agree with you.
It becomes a platform, though. Like once you build up the device sells other things. Like you won't buy an iPhone, but you'll buy AirPods and you'll subscribe to Apple Music and whatever their podcast service ends
so
up
being. So services could drive it. Yeah, yeah. So why Apple's iTunes was available on Windows and eventually.
And of course,
Android.
It works best with an iPhone and with a Mac and with an iPad. Right. You know, it's another gateway.
And Renee's right. Is like Apple devices can tend to be the gateway device for people getting more and more into the Apple ecosystem. Now, it's either you tried it, you don't like it, you go back to Android, and that's fine. Or for a lot of people, it's also, oh, wow, here's this new world that's opened up for me. Now everything I own is going to be Apple. Like, I think there's not a lot of in-between with that. It's usually either I tried it, I don't like it, or I tried it, and now I want all of the Apple devices. So, you know, Apple wins
that's
across
a good point.
The board
that's a
with
good
things
point.
Like that. So, People.
With an Apple Watch, it wouldn't take them too long before they say, and why am I using this crappy Android phone? When I could have a wonderful
Apple. I would get these extra benefits. Like I'd have the health app that really syncs way better than
you're
just
right.
10
it's a
things.
Wedge.
It syncs 20
things.
Also, I think it should be a point of pride for Apple because when I if I deign myself to be like the holy judge magistrate who is observing all companies and giving them scores, filling out their scorecards about how good a job they're all doing, it's really great that they make an Apple Watch that works great with the iPhone. It's at a lower level of difficulty to say that I'm going to make an Apple Watch that doesn't require that we've got to tear that into all kinds of other technologies that we can control and operate. It's like there's a difference between being a really good surfer at a wave pool and saying, okay, we're going to drive you out to an actual ocean where you have to deal with whatever, you're going to be prepared for whatever gets thrown at you. Let's see how well you surf then, Pink Boy. So that's one area in which, again, if as the intellectual discussion of how great and how capable are these companies, I like to see the ability to say, we don't care what you're using Google Docs on. It will work really great on any platform. And that really makes life totally suck for us on the Google Apps development team. But that's part of what our business plan is keyed upon.
I'm really glad my mom uses an iPhone because I did. She got her Apple Watch yesterday. She is so excited. Oh, nice. And she said, I promise I will always wear it. Because I was worried about her falling, and for fall detection alone, I could see them selling a lot of these. But you're right. If she were an Android phone user, then I would feel a little put out that I couldn't get this for her.
So, which Apple or family setup is a step in the right direction. I think it was a really good idea, especially for people who take care of or just have older people in their family that they worry about. I think that's a great step in the right direction.
I took a chance because I had it mailed directly to her instead of having it mailed to me, setting it up for her. But I also, I'm going to spend time with her on, FaceTime saying, okay, Mom, now. No, mom, no, don't. I don't know how hard that's going to be. I've never
had my mom took to it right away. She got the big phone and she didn't want to have it with her all the time. So this lets her keep her phone on the table or in her bag. Yep. And if one of us calls, she can see who's calling. She can go get her phone if she wants.
I think she's going to love it. And I think the out of the box experience is pretty clean, right? It'll just be a matter of me making sure fall detection's turned on. Some of the health features are turned on, which are not turned on by default, like the heart rate monitor. Yeah. She's actually excited about the idea that when she takes a walk, she'll have the heart rate monitor keeping an eye on her heart so it doesn't get too high. Even if it's little things like that, I think that's going to be a huge benefit to her. When Fitness Plus comes out, I'll be sending her an Apple TV because then she'll want to be doing the exercise. I could see this snowballing. And in fact, I'm going to get her an iPhone 12. She's still using an iPhone 6. She can't go to iOS 14. So she's going to need a new phone.
I want to boldface something that Lori said, that Apple was not the first fitness watch or smartwatch maker to put oxygen sensors on the device. They weren't the first with heart rate detection. They weren't the first with a whole bunch of stuff. But that's irrelevant. What they're the first and in many cases the only company to do is to make it useful, important, and relevant. It's not just a feature on a bullet chart. It is they clearly have this very, very serious, almost holy mandate that we're not just trying to sell gadget watches here. They are gadget watches. We enjoy selling lots of them and making lots of money from them. But there's no point in us making these if they're not actually actively contributing to the health of the person who buys it. Right. So we don't want them to suddenly use it just as a wristwatch, as a timepiece. We want them to discover that, it's giving me conditional little incidental reports on my heart rate, on my sleep rate, on blood oxygen saturation. And the fact that I'm being exposed to these numbers every day is making me more aware and thoughtful about how my body is operating. No other smartwatch does anything close to that. And I think that there'd be more competition if these other companies weren't so terrified of Apple, knowing that at the moment that they decide to make the Apple Watch either multi-platform or just operate completely independently of any other computer, they're gonna run the table. It's like, how do you compete with an Apple Watch on style, durability, battery life, as a piece of jewelry, as an actual health-oriented functional watch, in terms of support, in terms of people seeing it on your wrist, and the people that you admire and kind of want to emulate have these things on their wrist, whether they're people you know or people that you see at the Met Gala. I don't think I wonder if it really is that level of terror that says as soon as Barnes & Noble decides to open a bookstore in my neighborhood, we're closing down the bookstore because there is no way we are going to be able to compete with those prices and that variety.
I do have to say, I see more and more Apple Watches on the wrists of people who could afford Rolexes and who would have had Rolexes in the past. This is Neil Seibert's point exactly, is there's no credible competition. They just ran the table. Let's see. Should we talk a little bit about Apple TV Plus? Because as you aptly pointed out, Lori Gill, November 1st, 3 weeks away, I will be canceling Apple TV Plus.
You're going to cancel it?
No, because they just announced a new Bruce Springsteen documentary is coming. Uh-huh. God, diggity dang it. And apparently, go ahead.
I think we're not giving TV Plus the credit that it deserves, because it's not just the TV shows, which I think most of them have really kind of fallen short of what we think are good, but they have documentaries and exclusive movies, and it is growing. It is making a difference in what we want to see. It's still not, you know, the full streaming service that you might get from Hulu or Netflix or something like that, but it's only $5 a month. And I think it really is growing. The amount of content that you can get from TV Plus is getting a lot better.
Yeah. Well, I'll be watching Letter to You, Bruce Springsteen's documentary, over and over and over obsessively. And then I guess I didn't realize this, but they had almost completed season 2 of The Morning Show, which didn't really grab me, although they had a very good concluding episode. And they just had a couple more to shoot, and so they have decided to go ahead and film the last 2 episodes and complete it starting October 19th. Once they finish it, they can, I suspect, will be released early next year. So
they'll probably be able to release the other episodes early, too.
Oh, that's
too.
A good point. That's right.
Yeah, if they've got most of it done, they could release a lot of it. And if they're just recording or just filming the last 2 episodes, they could probably have those cut and edited.
I got it wrong. They had the first 2 episodes almost completed when COVID hit. So they have the rest of the season. How many? It wasn't that long. 6 more episodes?
6
like
episodes
that.
Or 8 total, I think. Yeah.
So they rewrote the remaining episodes to get COVID into it. Deadline has the story.
Mark, am I the only one that doesn't want COVID in my stories? I want to forget about that when I'm watching shows. I don't want it to be like mixed in with it. And I know like that's just not realistic. This is the way the world is right now, but I don't want you to address COVID in your TV shows. I just want to forget about it.
Although, remember, that's when The Morning Show, before it came out, they rewrote a lot of it to add the Me Too movement to it. So maybe that's what they're saying. Well, that's what we do on The Morning Show.
Relevance. It's sort of like the newsroom when they started pulling stuff into it.
Yeah, you're right. I'm a little bit behind watching Last Week Tonight because John Oliver is incredibly funny, but
sometimes, I know.
The past couple weeks, I'm not in the mood to be told about
depressing.
How totally screwed we are by
I already know that. By
the Supreme Court pick.
I don't.
And murder hornets,
how,
Andy.
No.
I love John Oliver.
Those, oh, look, that turned out to be not really a real thing. Yay! I ignored it, and it worked out okay.
John Oliver has turned out to be more homework than entertainment. Because it's like I know I need to know all this stuff, but I don't know if I want. Apparently, Apple TV has purchased a new musical comedy series, which will be aired next year, about a couple that gets lost in a magical town that acts like they're in a 1940s musical. I love
the cast:
Keegan-Michael Key, Alan Cumming, Fred Armisen, and Kristen Chenoweth. If you're gonna do a musical, that's a good bunch to have in there.
Yeah,
it was initially called, the code name of it, and you'll get this, Andy, was Schmigadoon, but they've changed. Apparently, there's a new. They're not going to use that. Although I wish they would. Keegan-Michael Key and an actress named Cecily Strong. Oh, she's regular on SNL, right?
Will
be on a backpacking trip designed to reinvigorate their relationship, which, like Brigadoon, they discover a magical town in which everyone acts as if they're in a musical from the 40s, and then they discover they can't leave until they find true love. It's kind of like Ted Lasso meets Brigadoon, I guess. I'll watch it.
That is such a strong like bench they've got there.
Yes.
Okay, we got Alan Cummings and Kristen Chenoweth. We're not talking about people who, I've always been a singer, and I took singing lessons when I was in college.
Shakespeare in high school.
No, if you were, yeah.
Cummings is the mayor of the town. Fred Armisen is married to Kristen Chenoweth. He's a minister.
Lucky man.
And Kristen Chenoweth, I know, is his morally superior wife. It sounds really good. You know, I think it kind of comes from this notion, probably because of Glee and then La La Land, that people are ready for TV shows where people burst. Cop Rock didn't really get that. That thing started.
Dr. Horrible.
Dr. Horrible was cool, and I think Glee really had a strong following.
The all musical episode of Scrubs that was written by Oscar and Tony winning
Buffy
composer.
And Apple TV's own Central Park, right? So maybe there is a market for it. I wish they keep
Broadway.
The name Schmigadoon. I think that's a good name.
Well, this is why streaming services are wonderful, because they don't necessarily, it's on a network, it would be okay. It's not the number one in a slot after three episodes. I don't care that we've filmed 22, we're canceling it, and you're never going to see it again. It's like, if the worst thing that could happen is that it doesn't get renewed for another season, but we get a full season and it's there available forever. Like One Day at a Time. That was one of the greatest reboots
I didn't watch any of those because I have a, me and Bonnie Franklin, you know, we had a little crush on her.
team Bonnie Franklin.
Team Bonnie. But I did enjoy the show, so it's worth watching the remake.
Oh, I have to say, it's one of the best. Every positive thing that you could possibly say about a Norman Lear style sitcom is absolutely true here, where the acting is great. The scripts are the dialogue is crisp and wonderful. It does get kind of heavy because they do want to talk about issues. But the great thing is that they don't do it in the format of like a very special episode in which we talk about racism in America. It's like, no, these people are not white people, and they deal with racism as an ongoing concern throughout their entire lives in this country. There was one of the favorite episodes is in the first season, one of the sort of like building storylines is that the mother does not know that her teenage daughter is, I don't know if she's lesbian or bi, but she's not heterosexual. And so they're building, she's really kind of terrified about the quinceanera, I can't pronounce it, but this the 16th birthday celebration.
Yeah,
right. Because of course, like she and her grandmother, Rita Moreno as the grandmother, as the most Broadway Rita Moreno you've ever seen in her life, wants to make her like this huge, wonderful dress, because, you know, this is my responsibility as a grandmother, that if I make you the dress and you see it and you don't burst into tears, I have failed and I have to start all over again. And the reveal episode was done in such a way where, like, it's such a beautiful thing, because she wanted to like take her partner with her to the party and not like, and that's, there's no way around it. And the payoff for all this was that the grandmother, who stereotypically, oh my God, I can't deal with this. It's like she gives her the first dress, did not get the reaction that she wanted. It's like, I have failed. I'm a start all over again. And then like the end of the episode, like she opens up like the second dress that the grandmother made, and it's this beautiful tailored like Armani suit that's more like in lining with like what her tastes are, and she bursts into tears for a million reasons. Like, oh my God, I'm sorry, I'm babbling, but that's how much I enjoyed that series. It was just so well done on every level, and it's the sort of thing where it probably would not have, it needed to have full seasons prepared, definitely going to be there, definitely going to be streaming, and had it been prepared for CBS or NBC, we would have not seen anything apart from
it's kind of interesting how online has changed television dramatically. Somebody in the chat room mentioned another musical TV show, Zoe's Extraordinary Playlist, which was kind of a flop initially and then became a huge hit streaming and online, and was renewed because of that. So that's, it's interesting. Yeah. Yeah. I think maybe we're going to see more variety in our TV programming. Thank goodness.
I'll mention this because it's wonderful, and also because it's totally in line with what we're talking about. Hugh Jackman was in a series for the network called Viva Laughlin, which was like that same level, where it was all about like a low rent like casino district in Laughlin, Nevada. But you have Hugh Jackman, Wolverine, but also like one of the best like Broadway stars. Like you signed up this crew so that Hugh Jackman will do like a custom Broadway number like once a week, and you canceled it after like three episodes. What is wrong with you? Maybe we could bring this back.
Here's a little bit from. You can turn up the sound. I'm a man of wealth and taste. Hugh Jackman doing Sympathy for the Devil. Now this was 2007.
Yes.
Now that I see this, I say I want to see the rest. I love Hugh Jackman. So this is a musical?
It's not a full musical. It was like an evening drama in which, but they would do musical numbers.
I don't mind people bursting into song. I kind of wish they would do it in real life.
Especially Hugh Jackman, for God's sake.
Yeah, he's a great performer. Wow. So that just tanked, huh? They did one season, two episodes, five unaired.
Yeah.
That's sad.
It exists. There are probably more Hugh Jackman musical numbers out there that are just like the Ark of the Covenant, like nailed inside a crate and in some warehouse where we'll never be seen again. That's just shameful.
Wow. Let's take a tiny teeny weeny break, a little time out, and continue on with the show with your picks of the week, boy and girl. Time for picks. And I'm going to go with Lori because I already have it.
So we have good taste in blood oximeters.
Yes,
apparently.
We do.
So yeah, when the Series 6 came out, of course, I reviewed the Series 6. And, obviously you want to review the blood oxygen monitor
its accuracy. 99%. 99%.
Good. You're good.
But I hope it's accurate.
Well, so I had to go buy an FDA-approved blood oximeter so that I could make the comparison, because there were some people in the world who made these really ridiculous claims that it's not accurate and it's worthless and pointless, which I completely disagree with. So I bought an FDA-approved one to find out the differences between the two. And yes, it's less accurate than the blood oximeter that I bought that you put on your finger. But it's only during circumstances under which I'm moving around a whole bunch.
Yeah.
A fingertip blood oximeter works even when you've been exercising or you're currently exercising. Like, that's where it wins. But you also don't wear it while you sleep all night long, and it doesn't track your blood oxygen while you sleep. So I'm just saying. But here we go. So if you want to get yourself a blood oxygen monitor, the Peak Life 360 is an FDA-approved pulse oximeter, blood oxygen monitor. And it's relatively inexpensive and it works really great. It checks your pulse and it checks your blood oxygen level. It works in just a few seconds. I think maybe 5 seconds is about what it is. You can walk around with it right on your finger if you want. You know, it's real easy to use. It's simple. You don't do anything. You literally you press the little icon the first time just to turn it on. And then every time after that, it just happens. It just does it on its own and it starts to track your stuff. So
that's cool.
Right now it's
Did it correspond to the Apple Watch pretty closely? I'm curious.
Yeah. So they were always off a couple of percentage points. So one might be 98 while one was 99, one might be 100 while the other was 97, but they were always within a 4-point range. And I haven't spoken to any doctors to find out how relevant a 4% change is, but I would say that's pretty much as close to accurate on both sides as you can get. This FDA approved blood oxygen monitor versus Apple's non FDA approved blood oxygen monitor. They were always within 4 points of each other.
Okay.
And the only time that there was any kind of discrepancy was when I was in the middle of exercising, and I would stop exercising specifically so that I could try it on my Apple Watch, and it just wouldn't work. It just wouldn't read it. And I think that has to do with like the fact that you had been moving around a whole bunch. So
I was doing Pilates the other day, and I thought, well, I wonder if I have better oxygen saturation or worse when I'm exercising. And I was pleased to see it was 99%. So I guess because you're huffing and puffing, and especially with Pilates where it's all about breathing, maybe that was your, when you exercise, you didn't get a reading. That's right.
Not on my watch, but yeah. I did on the peak through Peak Life 360, and it was always at a high percentage. It was always good.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Very interesting. Yeah. So I did buy a blood oximeter, you know, an FDA approved one early on during the COVID crisis, because I had been told, and I think it's still the case, that when your blood oxygen drops precipitously, that's the time to rush to the hospital. In fact, that's what happened with the president when he got down to 93%, which I kind of didn't seem like it was that low, but he was down to 93%, I guess, in as they keep using this phrase, abundance of caution, they started giving him oxygen. So, you know, clearly you want to pay attention to that, especially if you're diagnosed with COVID. Because then you want to, you know, you can stay at home and get better at home. But if your blood oxygen drops, you really want to keep an eye on that, because that's when you want to seek assistance. So I bought that proactively. But it's nice to have it on the watch. It worries me, though. 4 points is a lot. And that could, you know, if you were 93 and needing medical versus 97 and not, that's
I think the thing to keep in mind, and I don't know a lot about the science behind it, but I tried to research as much as I possibly could so that I can be as like accurate with my understanding of it as I could be. So even a fingertip blood oxygen monitor is going to have, it's not going to be 100% right. accurate just because of things in the world. So nail polish could affect it.
Right.
The ambient lighting in the room could affect it. Your movement could affect it. So I think 4%. Because like sometimes the Apple Watch was showing, you know, 100%, while the FDA approved finger one was showing 97%, and sometimes it was the exact reverse.
Right.
So I think that like if you consider all of the things that could negatively affect an accurate reading, I think 4% is really good between them. And one time having something drop a little bit, is I don't think anything to be concerned with. It's when you test it multiple times and you see that your blood oxygen level has gone down and it stays down. So if it goes down to 90 and it stays at 90 or 93 or something like that, that's when you know that there's a problem and that you need to go see your doctor.
Yes, yes, yes. A useful thing to have. And I think maybe if you're worried or you're somebody sick in your family, probably good to have an FDA approved blood oximeter.
Yeah. And it's that one's not very expensive.
Yeah. When I got mine, I think there was a lot of scalping going on because it was a lot more expensive.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's a little frustrating. Andy and Akko, pick of the week.
Just quickly, I'm going to underscore how valuable having a real FDA approved oximeter is. For me, the reason why I bought one early in the pandemic was after the first reports from people who had like overcome it, I was well as possible to overcome it, saying that this is like nothing, no other, like no flu. It's like nothing I've ever gotten. I've had such pain and such like disorientation that I realized that it was going to be important to figure out the difference. If I got sick, to figure out the difference between I'm really, really scared that I should go to the hospital right now because I actually am having a health crisis, or it's just that the COVID symptoms are so intense that I've never felt them before, and I'm feeling very, very scared. And the oximeter is like, okay, you put this on your fingers, like, well, you're still at 98%, and your oxygen level has always been 98%. It's not declining, so you probably need to ride this out and not expose yourself to more illness at the hospital, and also take more resources away from an already very, very overstrapped medical community. So I want to, that's such a great recommendation. I want to underscore that. I have two recommendations. Since we were talking about TV shows that turn into musicals, I have to recommend like the season 3 episode of Documentary Now, available on Netflix. It's that series that is like fake documentaries that are usually inspired by real ones. So in season 3, they did a mockumentary called Co-op, which is a parody of this super, super famous documentary about the recording of the cast album for Stephen Sondheim's Company, like back in 1972, 1973. So they wrote a brand new music. So it's the recording of this cast album. Of course, they had to write brand new songs. They're not song lyric parodies. They are like, you can sort of see where maybe they got influence from this musical here, this musical there. Brilliantly done, and partly because they got these amazing performers. They got John Mulaney is like the Stephen Sondheim guy, but they got Richard Kind, who I didn't know before, actually originated a character in a Sondheim musical. Renee Elise Goldberg, who was in the original cast of Hamilton.
Yeah.
Alex Brightman, who was the original cast of School of Rock. Paula Pell, who I knew as a comedy writer. You can see her like in the video right now. She's playing like the Elaine Stritch scene where she's like the sauced and saucy veteran like performer.
who's
a brilliant performer, but she just is not getting the song right, and she knows she's frustrated by that. She knows she's not getting it, and her voice is amazing, and I just loved it from start to finish. It was just so beautifully done. Like I said, you can get it. Not only can you get it on Netflix, but you can also buy the cast album that they recorded on any streaming service. So it's really, really great stuff. My original pick of the week was actually to underscore an article that just appeared on CNN.com the other day, which is a very comprehensive list of here are links for every single state to get to the page for mail-in ballot tracking. So after you mail in your ballot, it will tell you it really is like an Amazon delivery where it will show you at every stage, like it's been put into the mail system, it's been accepted by the balloting site, but it hasn't been processed yet. It's been opened and processed, and now finally your vote has been processed and counted. So it's really, really important. Number one, to make sure that you know that your vote was counted. Number one, but also I think the articles like this and resources like this are important because they absolutely put to bed any argument about, oh, well, there's so much room for fraud and mail-in balloting. We're going to see people voting 2, 3, 4 times and ballots that get thrown out and stuff like that. It's nonsense. I think most people listening to the show know that mail-in balloting has been done for decades without widespread fraud. But also, if you need to convince yourself or help other people to understand that this is a very, very secure form of voting. It's been done for so long that it's not something they're just trying off the top of their heads, and that your ballot gets tracked at every single point of processing, not only to make sure that if you voted that your vote was processed and vote and accurately tallied, but also that it's not going to be possible for you to vote twice or 3 times or 4 times. So very, very, the link is in the show notes. Really, really important stuff. Again, not only for yourself, but also to help other people make sure that they maintain confidence in a voting system that they should feel every confidence in,
yes,
despite other individuals who have it in their personal best interest to make you think that it's a vector for fraud.
Yes. It's kind of, if you think you might lose, it's kind of a good preliminary plan to just cast doubt in the whole process.
Yeah.
Unfortunately.
Especially, I did see last week, tonight, this week, and he made a very, very, one of the most important points he made was that every single election, an election day result is not a result. It's simply a prediction of a result, because always in any normal election, it takes days or weeks for final tallies to actually be counted. And so one of the things that caught me, weekly thing to get afraid of from last week tonight, is a projection that people don't accept is simply a projection to think, oh, well, gee, if this candidate was declared the winner in Pennsylvania, but no, then a month later, oh, suddenly they found all these magical ballots that mean that my candidate lost in Pennsylvania. I think we that's why I don't trust this election. That's why we need to get these militias in place. Like, oh, God,
yeah,
it's going to happen, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's going to happen, isn't it?
That is a terrifying thought. Renee Ritchie, your pick of the week.
So I chose something that would bring just a little bit of fun back into our lives, because like I said, with Baby Yoda and an Apple event, I'm collecting what I can for us to hold on to in these dark times. And this is, if you're not familiar with Ken Cascienda, he is I'll call him a legendary developer. He had a bunch of accomplishments before he was the third person drafted to the Safari team at Apple before it was called Safari back in the Alexander days with Don Melton. And, you know, I think he was the second person actually right after Don, and he helped create WebKit and Safari. He created the iPhone keyboard, the original iPhone keyboard. He created one of my favorite Apple Watch faces, the solar face. He's just legendary career. And he left Apple a few years ago, and he's done his first indie app, and it's called Upspell. And it's just a casual little game where you're given a bunch of letters and you have to try to make a word out of them. And the faster and better word you can make out of them, the more points you score. And he even, you know, sent me a snide message going, look how I YouTube, you know, and he got himself a thumbnail and he got himself a YouTube account, and he put up a video where he's just, you know, having a super amount of fun. There's Ken right there, you know, just a super amount of fun making this app and sending it out. And if you go through his Twitter account, there's just so many good causes that he's involved with going along with this, that it's not just, you know, a fun app, but it's not just good, it does good. And I was really happy to see. I can always use some, you know, something fun on my iPhone to take me away from doom scrolling Twitter or things like that.
Yeah, any predictions from anybody when we're going to see Big Sur? It won't be next
Which version?
Tuesday.
Intel or Apple?
The
Silicon?
Final release version, not a beta.
Well, I guess
Intel probably soon.
Sorry. Really?
Well, I think Renee was pointing out to us that it might come
the
when
Intel
the new
version
Mac
might
comes.
Come
yeah,
first,
yeah.
And then the Apple Silicon version. In other words, would it be next month when they talk about a new Apple Silicon Mac?
And will it have a lot of interesting features to demo that are exclusive to Apple? Like, we already know it's got a whole different recovery system and a whole different secure boot system, and whether they're going to demo anything else. Like, they'll probably demo iPhone and iPad games on it. You know, like, there's a bunch of interesting things they could do with Big Sur for Apple Silicon.
So I am doing, as you know, I do a show called Hands on Mac. It's just a short little thing that comes out on Fridays with tips for Mac users. And I'm doing the road to Big Sur, you know, what I'm doing to prepare for Big Sur. But it's like, you know, we record a couple of weeks ahead. So I'm just trying to figure out. I want to make the last piece installing it. Anyway, the second to last, I think, unless they delay Big Sur even longer, featured this app. And I thought I'd share this with you because I'd never heard of it. Renee, you probably have, because it's a Francophone app called EtreCheck. It comes out of Ontario. And it's you can use it for être, which means to be. So it's, I don't know what that means, to be checked, I guess. I don't know. But the idea, there are some issues. You remember Catalina deprecated 32-bit apps. You can't use them anymore. So that you can look at that under the Apple menu. You can look and see a little bit of that. But this does a much better job of telling you what apps will be incompatible. And we know that kernel extensions are going to be changed dramatically in Big Sur. And that's one of the things I want to prepare for, is make sure that I know which apps use incompatible kernel extensions. You're starting to see those pop-ups on Catalina, legacy system extension. And that's what we're a little preparing for. So this is a really handy program, free to use, $19 if you want the pro, or $18 if you want the pro features, which you may or may not need. It has some automatic repair features that the unpaid version doesn't have. But I think for figuring out your compatibility, potential compatibility issues ahead of time, EtreCheck is great. Now, I should point out that it is in the App Store, but that's a limited version, as always, with the App Store. The developer couldn't do as much. So there's also a download from the website, which is etrecheck.com. And I found it really a useful tool. I'm glad I paid for it. I'm going to keep it around. It has a lot of reports.
Like the 32-bit thing was like being run over by a Zamboni because they gave them 10 years. Yeah. And everyone's like, that's a Zamboni. It's never going to get here. I'm going to put a little table. I'm going to drink some tea. I'll get around. Oh, look. The Zamboni hits you.
Right. It's just, $15 in the App Store, $18 if you get it directly. But there are more features, obviously, in the version you get from the website. It's kind of, I don't know if any of you ever used it. I'd never heard of it even. And I found it in my research for this hands-on Mac, and I actually think it's kind of a useful thing to have around. Guess nobody's used it before. It was new to you, too. That's it for this edition of Mac Break Weekly. Catch Renee Ritchie on his YouTube channel, youtube.com/Renee Ritchie. He's at Renee Ritchie on the Twitter, writes for iMore and others. In fact, you had that piece yesterday on iMore about what you fantasize. Renee's fever dream about next Tuesday.
I have the best boss ever at iMore.
That might be this woman here, Lori Gill. She's the managing editor at iMore, at Appaholic on Twitter. Anything you want to plug, Lori, coming up?
Just pay attention to us next Tuesday on iMore. We're going to have all the event stuff.
Yeah, as are we. As I mentioned, we're going to be, Micah and I will be doing the live stream commenting thing, 10 a.m. next Tuesday. And then we'll assemble this team if you're all available, unless Renee runs off to a briefing or something, which he's been.
I have zero control.
Yeah, I know.
Zero control.
If he can, we'll be here. If he can't, he won't. But we will talk about it at what Apple announced.
It's going to be a hard day, Leo, because it's also Prime Day. And I just watched the faces of every former big media person I know say, wait a minute, iPhone Day is the same day as Prime Day. And then they all started just crying. Because that's usually a 24-hour thing. Like, they give 24-hour coverage. They cover every deal.
Yeah.
Like, it's one of the most brutal days in big media. And now they have an iPhone to cover as well.
I feel privileged RIP. That I can ignore Prime Day.
Me too. Don't tell Lori, please, though, because I can feel her staring at me already.
By the way, Renee and Georgia Dow's show is now out on YouTube, and it's awesome. Apple Talk.
Thank you.
Yeah, well done. You guys are great together. It's a nice team.
Thank you.
And Andy and Akko, of course, WGBH in Boston. When are you going to be on next?
I'm off this week due to election coverage, but I'm back on next week. So I'll have a good 3.5 days probably to think about what I want to say about announcements. Probably Friday, if my usual slot is Friday at 1 p.m. at WGBHnews.org. I will also be freaking out on Prime Day, but only because I really want to buy a $1,600 camera in 2021. And I would like to buy it using as few real dollars as possible. So I will be paying attention to any non-tech related items that are good things and an actual good deal, both of which are very, very low, thin on the ground on Prime Day, and recommending it on Twitter with my associate's account.
Camera.
Because exactly, if I can, again, if you needed some Halloween string lights and you were to buy that, no, actually what I'm getting at is that, like, if you're going to buy like a $5,000 like electric motorcycle, which are available on Amazon, and you were just to say, hey, I don't want to buy these Halloween string lights on Andy's feed, but if I were to click on that link and then buy that $5,000 electric motorcycle, I will probably get like some Amazon credits based on that purchase that will put me like a good $8 closer to my Olympus OMD EM1 Mark III. That's all I'm saying.
Ladies and gentlemen, that concludes this edition of Mac Break Weekly. We do this show right after iOS Today, so you can have an all Apple morning on a Tuesday. iOS Today starts about 9. We start a couple hours later, around 11 a.m. Pacific, 2 p.m. Eastern Time, 1800 UTC. The live streams are available at twit.tv/live. That's live audio and video. For those of you who watch Roku, yes, our app no longer works. Roku changed the API, and our app developer got a job. Oh, my God. So we are working in a way that you can subscribe to a Twit feed, but it won't have the live stuff. So go to YouTube. The YouTube app will have the live feed there. That's a good way to do it on your Roku. If you want to get on-demand versions, which is much more convenient, you can watch at your leisure or listen at your leisure. Those are available, A, from the website, twit.tv/mbw. You can also get those on YouTube. There's a whole Mac Break Weekly channel on YouTube. And best thing to do, really, would be to find a podcast application and subscribe to the feed you want, whether it's audio or video, Pocket Casts, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Overcast. It's audio only, but it's a great one, too. Pick your podcast, play it, and subscribe. That way you'll have it the minute it's ready of a Tuesday afternoon. Thanks for joining us, everybody. Now, as tradition dictates, I must say, get back to work because break time is over. Bye-bye.
Want more TWIT? Check out Tech News Weekly, twit.tv/TNW. Tech News Weekly is a show where Jason Howell and I bring the latest and greatest interviews to you from the people making and breaking the tech news. twit.tv/TNW.